I will first speak about our approach to religious harmony before setting out our transformation approach. Mr. Singh, in his speech, quite an important speech, raised 4 points. One, possible religious bias of top civil servants now and in the future. Two, our LGBTQ community. And three, a possible government statement on strict secularism. And four, updating the 1989 white paper on maintenance of religious harmony. Let me start with the point about religious bias of top civil servants. He raises the possibility of bias now as well as in the future. And he asks, and I quote, is there a danger that laws and policies could be tilted towards particular religious beliefs by top civil servants? If not now, maybe sometime in the future. Mr. Singh will accept when his words are transmitted to the public, many will interpret him in essence saying that top civil servants could be biased and they could act in favor of religious communities because of their own religious beliefs, both now and in the future. I would say leaving the public with that impression about our current top civil servants will be seriously wrong. They are persons who have dedicated their entire lives to public service, loyally, faithfully. If there is evidence of such lack of integrity amongst current senior civil servants, then I agree it should be raised, stated, and we must deal with it. If the statement was meant only to cover a future possibility without any hint or suggestion of a lack of integrity amongst current top civil servants, then that should have been made crystal clear. Since Mr. Singh has raised an issue relating to one of the key foundations of Singapore and one of the key foundations of our success, that's the integrity of our senior civil service, let me state the position categorically and quite starkly. The basic principle we follow and apply is that which Mr. Lee Kuan Yew said in August 1965, and I quote, we are going to have a multiracial nation in Singapore. We will set the example. This is not a Malay nation. This is not a Chinese nation. This is not an Indian nation. Everyone will have his place, equal language, culture, religion. Freedom of religion is guaranteed, but in the public sphere, public policy making, we don't make decisions which favor any one or other religious group. Neutrality and fairness are essential. Otherwise, in this small place, we will lose the trust of the people quickly. That goes for cabinet ministers, senior civil servants, the public service as a whole. And when these principles are not observed, they must be dealt with. Situation today, for the past 62 years, these principles, secularity, neutrality between religions, have been one of the golden threads in our public policy making. That is one of the key reasons Singapore is where it is now. My ministry in particular has a direct role in dealing with the issues relating to race and religion. We formulate, implement policies which deal with these issues. I have over the years worked with many senior civil servants, PermSec, directors of ISD. The current head of civil service was my PermSec in Home Affairs, outstanding officer, unimpeachable integrity. He has given more than 35 years, his entire adult working life, in the service of this country for the betterment of Singaporeans. It would be most unfair if he and his colleagues are tainted with the suspicion of religious bias without proof. I'm referring to the impressions that Mr. Singh's words will leave with many and not what he may have actually meant. How the words could be understood do matter. My current PermSec was Director ISD, PermSec Law, then PermSec Transport, 28 years in public service, again an outstanding officer who is driven by only one aim, which is to make the lives of Singaporeans better. Since last year, he has been working his guts out, leading the HCEG, coordinating and managing our pandemic response so that Singaporeans can be safe. We look for officers of this character and caliber, and they should not in any way be tainted with suggestions of religious bias in their approach. I have highlighted officers from my ministry in particular, because we are at the forefront of dealing with religious issues. We meet different religious leaders. We work hard to preserve religious harmony amongst the different faiths. Our integrity, honesty, reliability, and neutrality are key to us, and those are the currency we deal in. Whether the people we work with accept us depends on these factors. And this is important in another central way. We promote officers on merit. You don't want other questions to be asked. What is his religion? What is his race? Once we ask those questions for promotion, I think we will be in trouble. I don't forget what I said in 2003 and the leavening the effects of meritocracy by taking into account the position of minorities. What I say now can stand together and be qualified by what I said in 2003, though the latter point I emphasize is a purely personal view. Or take another officer beyond the two I mentioned, Issa Masood, graduated from MIT, formerly deputy director in MOE, director at ECDA, now CEO of MUIS. One day he will go back to the civil service. He should be assessed on the basis of the quality of his work and not on the basis of the quality or nature of his religious beliefs. And that goes across the public service. For me, when a police officer attends to a call at a house, you don't want people to think this is a Muslim officer or Christian officer or a Hindu officer. You want people to think this is an SPF officer. I personally keep close track of trust levels in our police force. They are now extremely high, and we don't want to get to the levels of some first world countries where people march in the streets to abolish the police force because of racial issues. It is not accidental that we have one of the highest levels of racial harmony in the world. That is the present. The quality of our civil service, their integrity, is a key reason why Singapore has succeeded. But I also want to acknowledge many of us have our own religious beliefs. Not everyone is or can be expected to be a saint. Sometimes there can be a tendency to see things through a religious lens or a personal perspective, and that can apply to all ministers, civil servants, ground officers. We have to guard against that. We have to avoid it, leave personal viewpoints, and look at it when you're making public policy through a secular perspective. On what is in the interest, you'll be informed by your religious beliefs, but you have to look at the broad majority and see what is in their interest. We have to jealously guard against any such tendency to look through a particular lens, whether it's ministers or anyone else, and we have to set the tone from the very top, insist on the secular approach, and be strict about that. Mr. Singh is reflecting, I think, what some people might feel. But I will say to him today, that's not a systemic issue, and we have to guard against it. And what is the safeguard? It starts with politics, how we conduct it. And religion, how important do we make it in politics? In debates, do we dog whistle? Let's be honest and ask, how often have speeches done that in this house? It is a responsibility on both sides of the house. You want an example of where it can lead to? Look at the United States, how votes are sought along religious lines. We go down that route, we will be in trouble. Mr. Singh also asks, what of the future? I will make 2 points. One, we have over the years developed institutions, a system, the Public Service Commission, PSD, rules that seek to promote the best officers and weed out those whose integrity is not clear. The assessments are multifaceted, and we have safeguarded the independence of the Public Service Commission because the degradation of the civil service will seriously damage Singapore. Second, having said that, my second point is, to be blunt, whether the senior civil service remains world-class and has integrity depends ultimately on who the ministers are too. The timber of our ministers will ultimately decide everything else. If the ministers are biased, they lack integrity, then that will spread, maybe slowly, but surely. The institutions that we have set up can delay the spread. It may depend on how long the top remains bad, but it won't be a happy situation. We have avoided these outcomes so far, and you only have to look at some countries outside of Singapore, many countries, including first world countries, to see what can go wrong and how quickly. Second, Mr. Singh spoke about our LGBTQ community. I have made the government's position clear. The amendments to the Maintenance of Religious Harmony Act, MRHA, make it an offense to urge violence on the grounds of religion or religious belief against any person or group. Action can be taken under the MRHA if a religious group using religion attacks a non-religious group, such as LGBT groups or individuals. Equally, if a religious group or its member is attacked by non-religious persons or groups, say LGBT, action can also be taken. Law is even-handed in this context. This was emphasized by me during the MRHA second reading and also during my speech at last year's COS. Regardless of which community, what your social, religious, or sexual beliefs are, everyone will be protected here, and I have said so categorically. LGBTQ persons, non-LGBTQ persons, we are all equal. We are not any lesser by reason of our sexual preferences. And if anyone stirs hate speech, either for or against any sexual or religious community, we will take action. Doesn't mean action will be taken on every occasion. Police will use their discretion, assess the context. We have set out our position. If Mr. Singh thinks that there should be any change or variation to this position, I will be happy to hear from him, in particular if he wishes to clarify what exactly is his position on our LGBTQ policies. I'll be happy to hear from him. Third point that Mr. Singh made was on secularism. He asks for a statement. Our secular stand has been made clear. When the government looks at policies, we do so in a secular way. We guarantee freedom of all religions. We don't favor any particular religion. Last year, November, at the Religious Rehabilitation Group seminar, I set out how our secular approach works. I also explained how our approach, for example, differs from the French approach. They are also secular. I've spoken about our approach at least 9 times over the last 5 years, and I don't think Mr. Singh wants a 10th speech. I can give Mr. Singh the references. Government's position is quite clear. Most people know what it is. The fourth point he makes is updating the MRHA WP, and WP here refers to the white paper. I can assure Mr. Singh religious issues, interaction of religious communities is a top of mind issue for us. Let me set out some things that have been done in the last few years. In April 2019, I delivered a very substantive ministerial statement titled Restricting Hate Speech to Maintain Racial and Religious Harmony in Singapore. I explained the government's position and approach in dealing with hate and offensive speech. Then we went further than a white paper. In June 2019, in the same year, with the support of the government, our religious leaders worked together on a commitment to safeguard religious harmony. They affirmed the shared values and the way of life of Singaporeans. This approach has underpinned the religious harmony we have. To date, nearly 700 religious organizations, 680 to be exact, and 73 community groups have affirmed this commitment. I would invite a careful study of this very important document. It is a commitment by the major religious groups and organizations on the principles of religious harmony that should govern us. It goes beyond past declarations on religious harmony. It details the many positive ways in which Singaporeans have been interacting across religions, and it encourages Singaporeans of all faiths to practice tolerance and acceptance. For example, allowing each other to profess our faiths and to do so in a respectful manner, eating together with others, even if we have different religious dietary requirements and practices, and attending the life events of others, such as weddings and funerals, even if those are held in the place of worship of that faith. That more than 680 religious organizations have committed to this specific call to action is to be celebrated. It won't happen in many countries. We followed that up. In October 2019, we amended the MRHA in several major respects to strengthen our ability to safeguard against and respond more effectively to threats to our religious harmony. So it can be seen, we have reviewed the 1989 white paper, we have taken concrete steps after that review, we have considered the evolving context, brought religious groups and leaders together, affirmed a new document of principles, and have amended the MRHA. The amendments also introduced a higher standard of behavior for religious leaders, for example, because of the influence they can wield. For example, if you're a non-religious leader and you said something in a private context, that may not be an offense, but if the same thing were to be said by a religious leader, the defense is much narrower. He's got to show that it was only a domestic communication between the leader and his relatives or member of his or her household. Given the many steps that have been taken, there is no immediate need for another white paper, but it's an issue which we will keep reviewing. I thank Mr. Singh for raising these issues. They are important. They allow us to examine again some key and important points.